is, I don't know if you can hear me because it is a little bit loud in here. It is Alcon day 2, it is Friday, and there are people there. Trust me on that, they're all down over there. It's the talent show in a little bit, but I am resting my feet because these boots are killing me.
Hang on.
These things, they're evil. So, yeah, I'm going to go sing at the talent show in a little while, so hopefully I don't fuck all that up. Should be fine.
Thank you.
sort of
George, thing. I'm sorry, but I stole your girlfriend.
Thank you.
message I was trying to convey got kind of lost, because I appreciate what Four Kids did in a way, and I know that sounds like heresy for a fan of the show to say, because obviously they did make a lot of changes, but at the same time they introduced these characters and this story to me, and this world to me. I wouldn't have known what Yu-Gi-Oh! Was without Four Kids Entertainment. And, you know, even if it's a censored and an altered version of the original, it made me want to watch the original, and I did, as a result. And you could kind of say the same about the Abridged series. I would never want to compare that to the original, or even the Four Kids dub. But it might make people want to watch the original, so I don't think it's something that we should be like, well, how dare Four Kids change this, because at least they gave it to us. And I feel like when I did season 3, it felt more just like, screw Four Kids, they suck. And, you know, that may be valid in some respects, but I was trying to sort of say, even though they did what they did to the show, I still have that because of that. And the same goes for Pokemon. I feel like, you know, as much as people say, you know, what they did to One Piece was a travesty, they made Team Rocket hilarious, you know. That's a big part of people's childhood. And that's something they did, you know. It wasn't something that was necessarily because of the Japanese version. They wrote all those awful puns and the fun dialogue between Jesse and James, and that's amazing what they did. That's magical. And so I wanted to sort of give them a fair shot, and I didn't. I don't think I achieved what I wanted to. So as far as doing what I did originally with Yu-Gi-Oh! Abridged, where I just made fun of the show, and then in season 3 where I sort of did a spin on that, and that's what people enjoy about it, and I don't want to confuse people, you know. I don't want to make people think that, you know, I have. Well, we were Sarah Turner, Captain Kirk, were you from the panel the other day? For those of you who don't know, I did a script reading. Are you the gentleman I was with? The Wade, Little Wade, that's right.
Dr. McCoy!
we did a reading of the Star Trek 2009 movie where we played each different character as one of our own characters, and Marek was Captain Kirk. He sleeps with green people. Do you have a green butt? Okay, we'll have sex later. But yeah, it was fun. I really enjoyed doing that. I don't know if he'll ever appear in any of my videos, but then maybe I'll sneak a sly around. Maybe Marek will just start acting like William Shatner when he returns. It is great to see you.
Shout Khan!
Khan! That wasn't nearly as dramatic as Shatner made it. The what bar?
I asked this to Valera yesterday after the Abridged Q&A.
Yes.
How would you feel about doing an Ultimate Muscle Abridged series?
How would I feel about doing an Ultimate Muscle Abridged series? It kind of is an Abridged series, because it's so daft, right? It's so silly. One of the reasons I think Yu-Gi-Oh! And Naruto work as parodies is because they take themselves so seriously, and it's so, that the drama is so heightened that it kind of is begging for it. Whereas Ultimate Muscle, I feel like you don't really have to touch that. It kind of does it itself. I'd love to see somebody else try it, because, you know, I think it could be fun in the hands of somebody else who knows what they're doing.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, never say never. Say again?
So many references,
To the current wrestling and stuff. I love the Macho Man cosplay, by the way, that's awesome.
Thank you!
He's back from the dead.
My God, can he hit him with the Muscle Buster?
He's broken in half! Right here. He started that off by saying, it's possible you don't know anything about this, and then said, whatever happened to that Digimon Abridged series, the one that I worked on with Shady and X
Abridgimon.
Masako. I can't believe I forgot Masako. It kind of died. I'm sorry. We wrote the first episode one night at Alcon, like 4 or 5 years ago, and we were all together, and we wrote it like in the space of 6 or 7 hours. And we had a lot of fun doing it, but unfortunately shortly after that moved to America, and then we all sort of went our separate ways after Alcon, and we only really converge whenever Alcon happens. And the plan was to write every episode whenever Alcon was a thing. Unfortunately, we just start having too much fun when we're at Alcon that we don't remember to do it. Curse me for having fun. But yeah, it's definitely something we loved at the time. But the more time that passed, it just became something that we didn't think we were likely to do again. Fortunately, Team 4-Star picked up the reins and they did their own episode 2, because everyone kept messaging Lanny Bator, the voice of Vegeta, saying, "Where's Abridgimon 2? And he had nothing to do with it. So he just got so tired of seeing these questions that he said, let's just make Abridgimon episode 2. And it's on Lanny Bator's YouTube channel if you want to check it out. But it's very different from what we did. He's basically making fun of all of us. He has one of the characters be shady, he has one of the characters be me, and I'm always talking about going to conventions and doing, like, I'm like, I'll fight this Digimon, but I first gotta go to Australia, sorry guys. and Shady's character's always hitting on all the characters, even his sister. It's very strange. But it's very funny as well. It ends with Lanny being woken up from a Coke binge by Taka, who has like a bottle of Jack Daniels and a Nappa puppet, and he runs in and goes, "Lanny!" And Lanny wakes up and is like, "Ugh!" And then Taka goes, "Did we make a Bridgimon?" And Lanny goes, "No!" And Taka just leaves. So check that out, it's really funny. And I heard Purple Eyes is making episode 3. So what I want is for Abridgimon to sort of be the Abridge series that get passed from Abridger to Abridger until it comes all the way back to us and we make the final episode. Who knows?
At that point, no one knows what's going on.
Nobody knows what's going on. It's a pass the parcel situation. Yes.
So you're in the upcoming Tales game. Is there any
pre-? Oh, no, we can't talk about that.
Is there any other games you're in there?
Yeah, there's some other games I'm in. Persona 5.
We don't talk about it.
I'd love to be in Persona 5 and they are dubbing
it's
it
not so much
where I live,
talk about
but
it,
I don't know.
Allowed.
I can't talk about that, and I can't talk about the other thing either.
It's like Fight right Club.
So you finished off time.
Yes.
How was it working with Chris?
How was it working with Kogathon?
Yeah.
On Tome, it was fantastic. For those of you who haven't seen Tome, it's a Flash animated series based in a massively multiplayer online RPG. And I played the really obnoxious role player called Nylock, who's really into character all the time to the point of just wanting to strangle him. And I've known people like that, so I had a lot of things to base that on. But working with him was fantastic. I think he got one of my best acting performances out of me that I've ever done in episode 6, where it's Nylock and Game Craze sitting on a bench and they're having this really serious conversation, and Chris told me, okay, just be you. And I don't know how many people have had to do this, but I spent a long time playing these really stupid, bizarre, exaggerated characters, and Nylock was kind of one of them for a long time. But then he had to break character in this episode, and I had to be me, and I realized that I'd never done that as an actor before. So it was one of the hardest things.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's releasing bloopers, and every so often I'll be doing like, fuck, let me do that again. But I'm pretty foul-mouthed when I get in the booth. I'm really proud of the job we did together. He got something really special out of me, and I think as a whole team that we all made something that ultimately he let me tell you, he started the show and a lot of people were telling him to give up a lot, and it's a shame, I hate to say it, but a lot of his close friends were saying, this is a waste of time, you're doing, this is stupid, there's nothing original about this, why are you doing this, stop? And he was very disheartened by that, but fortunately, he was so confident in what he was doing and in his idea that he kept going, and a lot of the people that were naysayers turned around at the end. So don't ever, if you ever try something that you believe in, and everyone tells you not to, if you really believe in it and you know what you're doing is worthwhile, don't give up. Because like what Kerb did changed a lot of people's minds, and he's super proud of the finished result. It's honestly, he thinks it's like the best thing he's ever done. And I think it's one of the best things I've ever worked on. So I'm very happy with it. And do check it out if you get a chance. We're all very happy with it. The final episode just came out like a few months ago, and we recorded commentary for it. And I say to him, you know, how proud I am of him, and it gets very emotional, so look out for that as well. Jack Atlas, did you just show up, or did I just not notice you? Oh, hi Jack, how's it going? Sure. It's ironic that Jack is the one who thinks, if you just in case you can't hear me, I'll talk louder. Absolutely, absolutely. I definitely want to do more Vampire the Masquerade Let's Plays with Marek.
That's right.
But speaking of where Marek left off in that game, I found out recently that there's a giant poster for something called Frickin' Chicken. So I'm really excited to see what Marek has to say about Frickin' Chicken back on that. He's like, Boxy Boxes is old news. Frickin' Chicken is where it's at.
Bloody hell.
Yeah, definitely. I'll definitely do more of that. I don't know if a Jack Atlas Let's Play would go over very well.
Hello, this is Jack Atlas, and we're playing Five Nights at Freddy's!
Oh, God!
Oh, my God, I'm gonna... Ah!
It's really scary, because there's a hole in the stage right here, and I can see a bunch of wires down. No, those are glow sticks. Never mind. Like, why is the wiring like green and red and pink?
Try dancing on it, it's terrifying!
I'm not doing that. Oh, you danced on it?
Yes!
My goodness. See, my dancing would be terrifying regardless of the hole on the stage. With the light blue shirt right there. When I was playing Freezer World, my most favorite lines. The line everybody loves me to say is,
when you see Vegeta, tell him I said, like a bitch.
I really enjoyed doing that one. And what else did I like? I really enjoyed the one before the Dragon Ball Z Kai abridged episode 2, where he just goes, by the fucking shell! I like that one.
Oh my god, I traded Vegeta for this.
I like that one. And the whole exchange when Goku first shows up, and he's like, I'm insane from Earth. And he was like,
he means Saiyan.
How real. I like that. I like that. I like anything with Frieza and Goku talking to each other. It's great, because Frieza's this evil genius mastermind, and Goku is Goku.
An idiot.
Oh, the bad fanfic with Masako. Yeah, well, I forget the lines that I said, but it was fun. What, give me an example. Yeah, because he emphasized the U or whatever, so it was like, Goku! Bad fanfics are great. I love them. Like, my show is basically a bad fanfic. I was going to cause Vegeta Looch pain! With the green shoulder pads. You love lumberjack matches. Who would win in a lumberjack match between Jack Atlas and Naruto? Everybody would be deaf watching it, I guarantee that. Who would win though? I mean, Naruto is a ninja, but Jack Atlas, what, is it a no disqualification match? Jack Atlas would run over him with a motorcycle. He gets the belt. He is the king of the ring, with the headband.
Are you planning to do any more songs?
Am I planning to do any more songs? Hell yeah, I am. I would love to do more songs. I'm a terrible singer, but I love singing. But I think I mentioned this at a previous Alcon, but I have this one specific idea I want to do where I abridge the whole Yu-Gi-Oh! Series in a parody of American Pie by Don McLean, called Millennium Eye. And Pegasus is singing the whole thing, and I think it would be great. I think it would be funny, but also kind of poignant. But I'm thinking of holding that off till the end of the series, so it sort of reflects back on everything. But the parody I really want to do right now is a Nicki Minaj song.
Oh, no.
Called, the original is called Starships, but I want to do Star Chips.
Star Chips to win the prize to save my sister's eyes.
Karaoke? I'll need to write it first. Right here. Oh, he starts off, when you're being creative, I'm like, what? Where does my inspiration come from? You guys.
Aww.
that's very true, and I was actually sucking up to you guys, but my comedic inspiration, I'd say, comes from all shows like Mystery Science Theater 3000, Space Ghost Coast to Coast, Mike Judge, creator of Beavis and Butthead. He's a huge inspiration to me. I like a lot of the stuff he's done, like Idiocracy and Office Space, King of the Hill and Beavis and Butthead. And I like the fact that he's basically, with Beavis and Butthead, it was just him voicing almost everybody. So you can see sort of how that influenced me a little bit. But aside from that, just Adult Swim in general. You know, I mean, you can see a lot of, like, I mean, the Moonanites are in my show, for God's sake. And then Quaffia was the villain of the new Yu-Gi-Oh! Bleach season. So there's a lot in there that I take inspiration from. But mostly you guys. Sappy stuff.
Sappy stuff. Sappy stuff. Sappy stuff. Sappy stuff.
The bunny, is it from, I know you're from Five Nights at Freddy's, but which character are you?
Springtrap.
Springtrap, okay. It is a trap. Yes. Does Mick Marrick sound like he has a carrot shoved up his nose?
Well, this one time I shoved a carrot up my nose.
I mean, if you watch the original Yu-Gi-Oh! Dub, he does kind of have this whole, I want to defeat the Pharaoh, kind of thing going on. And I sort of exaggerated that. A lot of the best gags and characters, I feel, are just exaggerations of what was originally there. And Marrick is a great example of that. The way I approached him when I first started writing it was, I wanted him to be funny, but I wanted him to be funny not because of like a catchphrase or because he was a reference to something else. Because a lot of the characters I introduced had just been like, oh, super special awesome, or Brooklyn Rage, or screw the rules. And I didn't want my
to be...
Give
me super strength.
Exactly.
It's very sexy, by the way.
Thank you.
I wanted Marrick to not be that. I wanted Marrick to sort of stand on his own and be funny because he was just funny. And I'd like to think I pulled it off. But people also just like saying Foxy Boxes as well, so I might have failed a little bit. But yeah, he's got that high-pitched voice because it's just... He's sort of like all those classic 80s villains like Skeletor and like... a lot of people compare him to the Monarch from Venture Brothers. But I like to just think he's just a very whiny kid.
Wah! I want to win everything! I want everybody else to lose and me to win. Do we have any questions? I'm going to be right there.
I don't know if you're following any of the Marvel DC films, but any of those in particular in the next year you're looking forward to seeing when they come out?
Any Marvel or DC films I'm looking forward to next year? Captain America, Civil War. Because aren't they introducing bloody Spider-Man in that?
I think that's the idea.
So hell yeah, I'm looking forward to that. I look forward to all of them. I think it's fantastic what they're doing. It's really cool to have a continuous series of movies taking place in the same universe with all these really awesome characters. And like, it's like basically reading the comics. You know, obviously they make some changes, but it's like following the comics and noticing things that appear in each one and spotting them and being like, ooh, that's cool. Guardians of the Galaxy was bloody fantastic. That was a real surprise. I knew it was going to be entertaining, but I didn't think I would love it as much as I did. They gave that movie real heart.
It was a dark horse.
It's fantastic, it really is. As far as the DC movies go, I don't know. I obviously, with Man of Steel being the only thing to really go on at this point, I didn't really like that much. It was just very hit and miss, it was a bit iffy, and it took itself way too seriously, in my opinion. I don't go to these movies to be bummed out. I go to these movies to be like, yay! And that movie was kind of like, oh.
Shit.
Who knows? Maybe Batman vs. Superman will be a good time. I think it looks kind of cool, but it could just be another Man of Steel. And Suicide Squad, I don't know. I don't really like what they're doing with Harley Quinn.
They turned her into Tank Girl!
Which isn't too far off her personality, but it's not Harley that I remember from the Batman animated series. That's the Harley I always know and love.
Yeah.
What about the Flash and Arrow?
Say again?
What about the Flash and Arrow?
I haven't checked out the Flash and Arrow yet, but
watch
I really
them.
Want to.
They're awesome!
Yeah. What do I think about the new Joker, Jared Leto, with his tattoos? It's to say, terrible. I am the Joker over and over again? I mean, I'm willing to give it a shot. You know, I never want to be like, well, that sucks after I see one picture. And he certainly seems to be giving it his all in the one clip that we've seen from the Suicide Squad trailer. But again, it's not the Joker I know and love. And even, like, Heath Ledger did an amazing job, but I'm always going to... And I guess I'm just a fanboy of the animated series, but I'm always going to think of Mark Hamill as the Joker. And I'm just... I'm hesitantly excited for them. And, like, I'm excited for every movie coming out. I guess that's one way of putting it. Yes, right here. You asked this question the other day, right, at the Abridged... somebody asked a similar question. How do you deal with motivational block? And it's something I deal with all the time. So I might not be the right guy to ask, because obviously I'm struggling with it. But the way I've recently been dealing with it is to have a schedule, like an actual printed out schedule on the wall that I adjust every so often. And if I can see it, and without having to just imagine what I'm supposed to be doing, then it helps me get things done, and get things done efficiently. But as far as like, if like I'm just reaching a creative like block, if I have like writer's block or something like that, and I just can't work, I take a break, I go watch a movie that I enjoy, and I come back to it later. Because the worst thing you can do is beat yourself up and just hit your head against a brick wall over and over again and get nowhere, because you get distressed and you want to give up on the script that, you know, could be perfectly good. It's really weird. I mentioned it with somebody at dinner the other day. I can rework a joke for weeks in a script and have it come out in a video, and people might just go, pfft. But I can write a joke in the space of a minute that I don't put any effort into, and people are like, that's the funniest thing you've ever written. Do that again. And I'm like, how? I wish there was a formula to it, but the best thing I can suggest is either take a break or, like I said, make a schedule that you can see. It's been pretty invaluable to me, and I hope it works for you. With the blue shirt and the strange... Like, what have you got written on your forehead? It's Margin Vegeta. Okay, I don't know much about Dragon Ball. You've got hair dysfunctional disorder. Yes. Oh. Dreaded is a good word. He asked, for those of you who come here, is there any point in season 4 or 5 of Yu-Gi-Oh! That you dread having to abridge? The big one is when Yugi leaves in season 4, because if you've not seen the show, there's a point where Yami basically goes crazy a little bit, and Yugi has to sacrifice his soul to the Orichalcos in order for, you know, because otherwise Yami would get taken. And it's a very moving moment, and it's a very big deal for fans of the show, and I know I'm going to screw it up somehow. Because I have to make that funny, ultimately, and it's the number of messages I get, similar, along the lines of, why do you make Kaiba hate Mokuba? That's not what they're like in the show. And I'm like, because them loving each other wouldn't be that funny, you know? But I'm dreading it, but also looking forward to that, because it's such a big part of the story that people are familiar with, that I know that other people are excited about it. And when I know people are excited about it, I get excited. The other one I dread is when Yami Yugi is on top of the train dueling Weevil, because he's on top of a train dueling Weevil, which means that the animation is moving constantly and I'm going to have to edit around that. And that's not going to be fun. Also, the ending of the show isn't going to be an easy task, because the ending has to be like either the best thing you've ever done or the worst thing you've ever done, and hopefully it'll lean towards the former. Wait, did I get the right former? Yes. Yeah, I'm dreading those, but also excited about them. With the pink on the shirt there. Say again? Who came up with the voice or with the idea for it? Both? The idea behind it is, I love the show Perfect Hair Forever. Has anyone seen that? Yeah. It's an anime parody that Adult Swim did several years back. And the villain of the show basically talks like this, douchebag! And I was like, that's hilarious. I want to have that in my show. And his hair is always changing color as well. And I just originally wanted to use that with Marek, because I didn't know what to do with him. And then I ultimately changed my mind. I was like, I want him to just be his own character. But Darts is one of those guys, you know, he's a great character, but I'm not, I feel like I really wanted the Quanfio character to fit in somewhere, and I couldn't think of anybody else he'd be appropriate for, so I used that for darts, and it seemed to go over really well. I had a couple of friends who were like, you ruined darts, but I'm like, I know, but it makes people laugh. The person doing the voice is Takahata 101, voice of Nappa from DBZ Abridged. Super talented, super funny guy, and his ad-libbing is funnier than anything I could ever write, so I know he's in good hands with that guy. And people seem to enjoy him, and I'm looking forward to seeing more of him. I really want to do a scene where he's talking to his henchmen, and he's like, all right, man, since you guys are having trouble defeating that swear-old guy, I'm going to have to wank you. You're going to what? I'm going to wank all of you, one by one. I'm going to start with you. Your wank is the lowest wank of all. I'm looking forward to doing that. I'm looking forward to everybody being wanked.
With
the big
scene.
Yes.
It's
going to
be me.
Do you have any,
plans,
I think,
side
projects in possibly
drop? Do I have any planned side projects that I dropped that I'd like to go back to and revisit? Well, the Naruto spoof sequel is definitely something I have dropped and come back to recently. But as far as stuff that really hasn't just seen a light of day, I wanted to do a Death Note parody, and I talked to somebody the other day about this, because they said, why have you never done a Death Note parody? And I always had this idea of Marek and Bakura doing an abridged series, and voicing all the characters, and Marek's characters all sound exactly the same. And Bakura has a really shitty microphone, so for some reason it sounds awful, but I think it would be really funny in a really meta way. And I think Marek would call it Kill Book, the abridged series. And I think that would be a lot of fun. What else is there? I did try a Dominion Tank Police abridged series one time, because I was a huge fan of that show, but it didn't work very well. And I showed it to a few people and they said, this is the worst thing you've ever done. So I'd like to revisit that and make it not the worst thing I've ever done. Because I love that series, and I love the characters in that show. But yeah, there's a bunch of stuff that I've just left fall to the wayside, unfortunately, with the purple hair.
Do you know how we have always have like Marek and Bakura together and like gaming games? Do you like visualize them like living in an apartment together, or like does Bakura have a house and Marek just always?
It's a good question. The question was, whenever I do like videos with Marek and Bakura hanging out together, like the Let's Plays where you hear Bakura in the background, do I visualize them as living together in an apartment, or do like they have a separate living area, like Bakura has a house and Marek has a house, and they just sort of visit each other? When I visualize it, I think of Marek in his like Egyptian tomb setup, but with like a laptop, and it's plugged into like this stone wall with like tablets and everything. And Bakura's just there. He's visiting from Japan or whatever, and they want to play.
He's raiding the fridge.
Oh, who knows? Maybe Bakura's on Skype or something. I don't know. But whenever I play The Sims, they're roommates.
He's raiding the fridge.
I download lots of mods to get their hair to work. Banda Keith, yes. Make this a very American question. If I wanted to work on any new projects, what would I work on? Persona 5. what would I work on? Like abridged-wise or anything? Oh gosh. That's a big question. I might have to come back to you. Honestly, I'd love to do my own, like, and I know everybody's done this and it's kind of redundant, but I want to do it just because it's something I like, I'm passionate about. I'd love to do like a movie review series where I just talk about movies. And you know what? I'd love to revisit the Yu-Gi-Oh! Manga reviews that I did back in the day, because I really enjoyed that. Hey, you guys enjoy it. But yeah, I'd love to review movies. I'm a big movie fan, and it would make me have to watch a lot of films as a result. And I don't watch enough films as it is these days.
Sorry,
I saw Coco. Yeah, I know that's a terrible, that's not a very funny answer, but that's what I'd want to do.
Okay.
Yeah. Right, yeah. From my own abridged series, who are my favorite characters? Well, it's hard to go wrong with Marek. I've talked about this a lot. He's basically drunk me. Whenever I get drunk, I get very loud and I have terrible ideas as to what we should do. There's an infamous... Speaking of favorite characters, Naruto is one of my favorites to voice and to write for. because I know that whatever I write, I'll end up recording something completely different that ends with fuck. I've told this story a million times, and I apologize to those of you who've heard it, but I got, the first time I ever got completely wasted was at the second Alcon I ever went to, and I was cosplaying Naruto,
oh, no.
To the point that when I was so drunk that I actually believed I was, I was Naruto, and I was like, why don't you prove it? Oh, believe it! I believed it, that's right! I was at Wagamama's and I was eating noodles and I said, this tastes almost as good as Sasuke's ass! Sasuke's ass! Sasuke's ass! Sasuke's ass!
Sasuke's ass! Sasuke's ass!
I have a very strange power over you guys. Yeah, a very strange night that was. But as far as like other favorite characters go that I don't often play.
I'm very confident.
I love playing the guy in the mock remark reviews, like the very sophisticated wrestling fan. It's really, like, a lot of people are like, why are you doing that stupid voice? Because for those of you who haven't seen that, I basically do it, I play a character like this who just loves wrestling and is very picky about it. Because I sort of view the wrestling community online as that kind of person, because we're watching bloody wrestling, but we're looking down our noses at it at the same time, even though we love it. So, what's that?
If you take the road going
I know
down
you
there,
see, exactly. Yeah.
Follow it
but yeah,
showcase.
I'd say those are my favorite guys.
There's a Wagamama, there's a Yo Sushi next door to it.
Yeah, I saw, because I used to go to cinema a lot.
What do I actually think about where the WWE is right now?
That's the uni or DMU? Yeah.
It's a bit...
Yeah, I graduated.
It's 50-50 on that,
really?
Because... I think it's amazing that we have people like Seth Rollins as champion, and just until very recently we had Kevin Owens as NXT champ, and now Finn Balor. And there was a time when those people would struggle to even get in the company. And it's really refreshing to me as somebody who started watching wrestling when it was either The Rock or Austin or Triple H or The Rock or Austin Triple H in the main event. And now I'm seeing like Seth Rollins versus Sting or Seth Rollins versus Dean Ambrose. And these are young guys who are super talented, who can do things that nobody 10 years ago could do. And it's a very cool roster right now. Unfortunately, they don't seem to know what to do with them half the time. I think they make Seth Rollins look like a bit of a chump as a champion. And while he is a heel, he should be at least able to win one match without resorting to having five other people run in or leaving or having The Undertaker show up and have Seth Rollins and the referee disappear and never get seen again until the next night on Raw. John Stewart, exactly, that's another thing. But again, I think the fact that we have this great roster and we have... like the Divas Revolution is a bit of a misfire in my opinion. I think that the Divas are super talented, but they're calling it a revolution and all it is just random tag team matches. We've only just had Charlotte win a title shot, and that's the first thing that's actually resembled an actual revolution, which really, all they presented to us is, these are new divas, enjoy them, bye, you know? A lot of you are very confused by what I'm talking about right now. But yeah, I love it, and I also think it's a bit eh, but I'll always love wrestling. And there are a lot, fortunately, there are a lot of alternates to the WWE. I was just watching Ultimo Lucha on the way over from America, and that was fantastic. That was a great show. So yeah, there's the WWE, and it is what it is. And I love wrestling. So I will never not watch it, but I may have... Are you having an analog shirt on? Holy crap, that's awesome. That's really cool. Yes. What's my favorite NXT special so far? I saw the Brooklyn one, that was brilliant. The Bayley versus Sasha match was incredible. The crowd reaction, that was amazing. I loved the one that had the triple threat. Was it triple threat women's match or was it four-way women's match?